does that even mean, Bauer's Game Corner?
Ahoy there, YouTube! I'm back again today for another game review, a special Kickstarter review, and today I'm very excited to check out Ladder 29 from Green Couch Games. This is for 2 to 5 players, take about 30 minutes to play, and it's for ages 10+, and in Ladder 29, this is a trick-taking game in which, well, you know, it's a trick-taking game, so there's not really much theme, but you're going to be playing as firefighters trying to climb the ladder to room 29 to rescue somebody, or you can get more points, and then you win the game. Theme, not so much, but this is a trick-taking game with a lot of interesting quirks that all kind of work together, but do they work together well? That's the ultimate question. Let's open it up, and I'll tell you what I think. Alrighty then, we're going to take a look at what you're going to get inside of Ladder 29. So first of all, we got a handy-dandy rule sheet. I do want to mention, this is the promotional copy I have in front of me, so take everything you see here with a grain of salt. Obviously, your rules are not going to look like this. But this is 3 pages, double-sided, no pictures or illustrations or anything yet, but it's still very simple and easy-to-learn game. So I'm assuming big thumbs up on the rule booklet, but since I don't have it, this one is perfectly serviceable, so thumbs up on that one. In Ladder 29, you're going to be playing as firefighters trying to get to this score right here. The theme kind of falls through on that, but you're going to be doing this in a trick-taking game. But there are lots of quirks to do in this game, so let's go ahead and talk about the components, and then we'll get into the gameplay, and I'll start talking about those different quirks. So over here, we have the scorecard right here. The scorecard is going to be where you're going to be keeping track of your score, obviously. It's very important in this game because there's going to be a drafting phase in which you're going to draft these cards right here, and whoever is in last place is going to be drafting first. Also, another thing with the scorecard is you can never have the same score as someone, so there's never going to be a tie in this game. If you land on someone's spot, so let's say blue was supposed to get 1 point, then instead of going right here, they would go 1 point up, which can be very useful. Now, next thing I want to mention here is, yes, it looks like green has a big advantage, and they do in theory because they're starting at 4 points, but that means green is going to be drafting last, which means they're kind of going to get stuck with either one of two cards, but I'll show you how that works in a minute. Next over here, we have the hotspot cards. And these cards are going to dictate how many points you will earn if you're the first person to go out or the second person to go out, so on and so forth. So let's just pretend we have a 5-player game. If you have a 5-player game, that means you are going to deal out 5 cards. Now, the start player card will always be out here. Every single round, this will be out here. So you're never going to get stuck with one card. You will always have at least 2 choices. So now, yellow would draft one of these cards. Now, what's really interesting about these cards is they will give you something that's hindering you. So, for instance, this one. Runs must end with odd cards. So if you were going to play if you're going to play a run of 4 cards, you could not do 3, 4, 5, 6 because it would end with an even number. You would have to do 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 or 3, 4, 5 or anything that ended with an odd number. However, if you get in first place, you're going to get 10 points. Now, on the flip side, you can always take the start player one if it's an option and it's still there. This one is only going to gain you 6 points if you're the first person out, but it's going to be much easier to go out because you're guaranteed to start with control, which in theory gives you a much higher chance of winning the round. So yellow would take the first card and they might say, oh yeah, runs must be a single color, I'll take that, and this guy might take this, and then this, and then yellow might be stuck with either the start player or may only lead singles. This would normally never happen because somebody would take the start player, but we'll just pretend we're the start player, we'll put it right there. Now, that's how that phase is going to work, but you're going to have more information because before you draft these, you're going to be dealt 13 cards. And everyone's going to be dealt 13 of these cards, and you're going to get a look at your cards before you decide on what you're going to draft. Now, what are you looking at with these cards? This is a good time where I can tell you what you can play, because this is not your normal trick-taking game where you're just going to play out one card, then someone's going to try and beat it, and someone's going to try and beat it, and you're all going to wipe it. No, it's not like that. How this works is you're able to play hands of cards. So you could play just one card, and I could play a 4, and this would be able to be beat by a 5 or a 6 or a 7 or an 8. Now, another thing that I want to mention that's different about this game as opposed to a lot of other trick-taking games is you don't just go once around the table. So if I play a 4, he plays a 5. Let's actually just demonstrate it. 8, This guy would pass because passing is always an option you have in this game. So he passes. This guy plays a 9. That doesn't mean he wins this necessarily, because then I could come back and I could come back with a 10. And then this guy might come back with an 11. And this guy might come back with a 12. And then I might pass. And then this guy might come out with a 15. Now, one important thing here is you might say, why don't you just play a pair of cards? Because that is that's illegal in this game. If someone leads with a single card, you have to play a single card, with one and only one exception, which I'll tell you a little bit later. It's not going to happen too terribly often. Now, another thing I want to note is that there is a color suit rank here. This will come into play time to time. So red cards are better than blue cards, are better than yellow cards, are better than green cards. So if I played this yellow 8 right here, it could be beaten by a 9, 10, 11, 12, or it could be beaten by a blue 8 or a red 8. So you can play a single card. You also can play a pair of cards. Boom, just like that. And once again, this will be beaten by a pair of 9s, pair of 10s, so on and so forth. You can play 3 of a kind, which I actually don't have in this example, but you know what 3 of a kind looks like. You can also play a run, and the rules with runs are it has to be at least 3 cards. That's it. They can be different colors. It does not matter. But with the runs, it has to be 3 cards. It can be as long as you want. So if you had 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and you just got lucky and you had maybe like an 8-card run, you could play that 8-card run if you ever got control, and you'd probably be guaranteed to win. But someone else could still beat that. When it comes to runs, so let's say my run was 8, 9, 10, like this. This could be beaten by 9, 10, 11, 10, 11, 12, 12, 13, 14, or it could be beaten by another 8, 9, 10 as long as they played a red 10. So only the last card matters in getting outsuited when it comes to the runs. So that's what you're going to be playing on your turn. Now, before you're going to do that, though, before you draft these cards even, you're going to take 3 of these cards and you're going to pass them to someone on your left. So let's just say, I don't think I can use these 3 cards. I'm going to secretly pass these to the player on my left, and the player on my left is also going to pass me 3 cards. I'm going to look at my hand, and now we would do this drafting phase, which I already showed you how to do. But now it should hopefully make a little bit more sense. So let's just say I got a lot of runs, but none of them end with evens. Or maybe I have only pairs and 3 of a kind. This would be a great card to take because I know I'm not going to have any runs that would end with odds. But each one of these hotspot cards is going to give you a hindrance. So now what you're going to do is you're going to see who the start player is, which would be us, and that player is going to lead off. And they can lead off whatever they want of the things we talked about. So let's just say, for this example, I'm going to lead off. Yeah, this is going to lead off real nice. So I'm going to lead off this 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Holy moly, I'm leading off. Boom, I'm leading off this. This is a perfectly legitimate leadoff. I'm leading off with an 8-card run. And chances are no one else is going to have an 8-card run. And chances are they're not going to have a higher 8-card run. So this guy would say pass, 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 pass. Now, I mentioned a little bit earlier about how there is one occasion where you can play off suit, so to speak, where if someone played a pair, you could play something else. And that is if you have 4 of a kind. Getting 4 of a kind is very difficult to get in this game, but if you have 4 of a kind, then you can play that, and that immediately beats anything else out there, unless it's a higher 4 of a kind. But that is the only time that you were able to play something else. I think that's called a fire blaze. It's got some specific weird name. What was that? The flashover. If you play 4 of a kind, it's a flashover, and that breaks the rules that allows you to do that. But other than that, there's no other thing. So I would probably take this. We just throw that over to the side. You don't score any points for these, because remember, you're going to score points based on going out. And now I'm looking at my hand, and I have a big problem. I don't have any more runs. I don't have any more pairs. And this is why you really want to try and plan out your hand. So I say, maybe I can take it with this 15. So I probably don't want to lead the 15, though. I probably want to lead a 0 with the knowledge that it's going to come back around to me, and chances are, so let's just say this guy played a 4, 8, 12, and then I'd say, oh, I play a 15, and I might take it, and I got rid of 2 cards, not to mention I'm going to be able to lead off another card. So there's definitely a good deal of strategy here with that. So you're going to continue to do this until someone goes out. When someone goes out, they're going to get the first place points on their card, albeit it could be whatever their card is. So I would be playing for 10 points for first place. This guy would be only playing for 6 points. Once that person is out, they are done with the round, and
the person to the left of that player becomes the new lead player, which can be a big deal in the game. That player is then going to lead, and then the next person that goes out, whoever was in second, is going to get the second person to get rid of all their cards, is going to get the second place prize. Then the third person to go out is going to get the third place prize. And if you're playing a five-player game, the fourth person will get the fourth place prize. And as I mentioned, whoever's in last will always, always get zero. Then you're going to take all these cards, except for the start player. You're going to put them over to the discard. You're going to move the score tracker. You're going to deal out more of these. Everybody's going to get 13 new cards. You're going to wish, wash, and repeat until someone gets to 29 and has the most points. Now, let's start talking about the four special cards that I talked a little bit about, then we can get out of here. So first, we have the Chief. And what I like about this is it says exactly what each one does. Highest single card may not be played in sets or runs, but you're guaranteed to win with this all the time, unless, of course, someone plays a four of a kind on you, which I have seen happen and really annoy the other person. They let off with this card because it's like, oh, I got this guaranteed, and then somebody four of a kind, and it was great. Next, we have the Dalmatian, which is wild in pairs, and it also can just be played as a zero in runs or as a single. So yeah, wild in pairs. So you could, in theory, have, you know, a pair of, oh no, you couldn't. You could have a pair of 18. This is the second highest single card, and it tells you that right there. This also cannot be played in sets or runs. And then you have the Rookie, which is the highest pair that you can possibly get, but you have to get the other Rookie. And there's only one other Rookie card in the game, I'm pretty sure. So taking this card is a little bit of a dangerous proposition, unless, of course, you know you can use it in a 1-2-3-4 kind of run. So those are the special cards in the game. You go until somebody gets 29 and has the most points. That person will be the winner of Ladder 29. That, in a nutshell, is how the game is played. Alrighty then, Ladder 29 for Green Couch Games. What are my final thoughts? Let's go over the pros. Let's go over the cons. First, on the con side, if you don't like trick-taking games, this one might not be for you, even though this is a very different kind of a beast of a trick-taking game. So I still would recommend trying this, but what I mean by that is it's still a very simplistic game. A lot of the time, the choices you make are going to be very obvious or simple choices. Another comment I have in this game is there's going to be points where your hand, you just look at your hand and you're just like, I'm finishing last. This stinks. But the good news is there's also probably someone else at the table, especially if you're playing with four or five players, who's looking at their hand and is like, I'm finishing last. But yeah, you will come to those situations where it's like, I just have nothing that I can do. There's no way I can get control unless someone next to me goes out, which is another interesting aspect of this game. Theme does not come across at all, as I mentioned in the intro, but it's a trick-taking game, which you kind of should expect that. Any other cons that I have with the game? You know, it can be a little bit difficult to teach just because there are some unique quirks in there. And oh, I wish the player aid card was a little bit more useful. I'm hoping, because right now it's double-sided, so I really hope they take the player aid card. They take the opportunity to put something useful on the back of the player aid card instead of just making it like that. Some of the hotspot cards seem slightly imbalanced, and one in particular. But that being said, when we got to that card, the person who got it was like, oh my gosh, this card is terrible, but I want to try it out. And we were like, oh yeah, that card is so terrible. And then he went out first. And then we were like, oh, well, maybe it's not so terrible. So not quite sure about that. But there are definitely some ones where you're like, I would much rather have this one than that one. But that, I kind of feel like that fits in with how the game is supposed to be played. Rambling here because I don't have too many cons. Moving on to the pros, I'm not a big trick-taking game guy. I mean, I enjoy trick-taking games, but I never really recommend them. However, this game might buck that trend. I can wholeheartedly recommend to you Ladder 29 if you are a trick-taking game fan. And if you're not a trick-taking game fan, and maybe you like them a little bit, then yes, I still recommend you check this one out. If you're just completely hate trick-taking games, then yeah, you're probably going to pass on this one. But man, this game does some really interesting things, and I liked how they did it a lot. So first and foremost, I liked the scoring, and I was not on board when I first saw how the scoring worked, but I really did like it. It just avoids all tiebreakers, and when you do, you know, jump on top of somebody and then you get to move one extra point, it's like, ooh, that's awesome. And I enjoyed that. I like the fact that the person who's fifth place doesn't get any points at all. I love the alternate, not alternate victory conditions, but alternate victory hindrances you have. I love the fact that everybody has their own unique quirks, where it's like, oh, you can't play pairs, so I know that I'm probably going to be safe on this pair in maybe like a 3 or 4 player game.
I just like that. Everybody has their own unique thing. Everybody's going for different scores. And yeah, I just really enjoyed the game. And I mentioned that I like the fact that people don't score any points in fifth place, because that kind of gives you a little bit more room to gamble. And I always love when a game gives me room to gamble. So let's say we're playing this game and somebody has, you know, just, you know, a huge lead or something like that. I might take a really difficult card because I know if I get first place and that guy gets fifth place, then bada boom, I'm right back in the game. I like the drafting, so it has a little bit of a catch-up mechanism there, where if you're in last place, you get to draft the first card, because that can be incredibly useful. I like the fact that you're not stuck with the hand you get, you just get to pass three cards, because I love playing Euchre, and I always love when it's the shoot the moon, where you get to, like, take two cards from somebody else, so I like the aspect that you're getting these three cards, and they might just work for you. You know, overall, I just like how everything works in this game. It reminds me a little bit of Aeon's End. Not because the games are similar at all, but because they took a formula that is very systematic, that has tons and tons of games in that genre. And I felt like they added a bunch of little tiny quirks, and all these little tiny quirks really worked well together. So Ladder 29 from Green Couch Games is yet another hit, yet another game that I think will be another rock-solid game for them. I could see it, you know, I don't know if it's going to be a hit, because it is a trick-taking game, and that's a really niche genre nowadays, but man, I think a lot of people are going to like this game. If you like trick-taking games, very easy recommendation. For everybody else, I still recommend trying it, because it's a very cool, unique experience. That is Ladder 29 from Green Couch Games, one that I am definitely highly recommending you check out. Currently on Kickstarter, right now. Yeah, it's right now, or it's over, at which point you can just go buy it. But if you enjoyed this review, please be sure to click on that subscribe button down below in the comments below. Let me know, trick-taking games, do they do it for you? And as I mentioned, I really do enjoy trick-taking games, but I just never recommend them because I always want more from my trick-taking games. I want a little bit more meat. I would love it if there was a big, meaty 2 to 3 hour Euro game that had a trick-taking mechanism in there. And I'm sure someone's going to mention it in the comments below, but I think that'd be really cool. So because we're always like, let's add deck building, but I want deck building not as the main mechanism. I want it as a side thing. I want trick-taking, like a really good trick-taking element, to be in a nice heavy meaty game. I think that'd be a cool element to mix in there. But let me know in the comments below, whoa, deck building, trick-taking, I want that game. Let me know in the comments below, trick-taking games, do they do it for you? And as always, thanks for your time, YouTube.